السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على نبينا محمد الذي أرسله الله رحمة للعالمين، ففتح الله به الصدور وأنار به القلوب وفتح به أعينا عميا وآذانا صما وقلوبا غلفا. صلوات الله والسلام عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن استنى بسنتي وتبع إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إخواني في الله، is the microphone clear؟ طيب. We're continuing with our lecture series regarding the scholars of Andalus. Inshallah, one night we shall be taking the scholars of Andalus, and the other night we shall be taking about the story of Muslims in Italy. This is a story that few of us know, the history of Muslims in Sicily, where the mafia came from. Before the mafia entered Sicily, the Muslims were there before, and they built a great civilization. Tonight, Ikhwani fillah, we shall be talking about one of the greatest Islamic scholars, not only from the land of Andalus, but of in entire Muslim history, well known since he was born until our day today. We are going to talk about the Imam Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, rahimahullah. Ikhwani fillah, one day this Imam, 26 years of age, he comes to the mosque to pray Salatul Janazah for the son of one of the ministers. He comes to the mosque to pray Salatul Janazah for one of his friends, a son of one of the ministers. As he enters the mosque, he sits down. One of the people tell him, he's 26 years of age, قُمْ فَسَلِّ. Stand up and pray Tahiyatul Masjid. So he stands up quickly and he prays two Tahiyatul Masjid. And he sits down. He goes, he buries the minister's son, and he comes back to the mosque after Asr. After Asr, he enters the mosque, and he wants to pray Tahiyyat al-Masjid. As he's about to start his prayer, he's told, Ijlis, هذا ليس وقت الصلاة. Sit down, this is not the time of prayer. So he gets confused between these two situations. I entered the mosque, I tried to sit down, I was told, no, stand up and pray. I entered the mosque again, and I'm told, don't pray, sit down. How do I reconcile between these two things? And he was very confused, 26 years of age. So he asks, who is a scholar that I can take knowledge from? And he's told, go to Abu Abdullah ibn Dahun. Go ask him what knowledge you can take from. So he goes to this scholar of the Malikiya, and he asks him, what knowledge can I take from Sheikh? The Sheikh tells him, go and read from the Muwatta of Imam Malik, one of the most authentic books written by the Imam of the city of Medina, Imam Malik ibn Anas, who passed away in the year 179 of Hijri calendar. He has an excellent book of hadith, and this book has been explained by many scholars. Go read it. Ikhwani fillah, 3 years he spent researching and reading in fiqh until he became one of the foremost scholars, not only in the land of Andalus, but of entire Islamic history. Ikhwani fillah, this is our scholar for tonight, one of the greatest scholars of an Islamic history that came from the lands of Muslim Spain and Portugal. And he's also buried there, one of the great scholars, Imam Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi. Ikhwani fillah, his full name is Ali, is Abu Muhammad, he's the father of Muhammad. علي ابن أحمد ابن سعيد ابن حزم الأندلسي القرطبي الظاهري اليزيدي. He was born in the year 384 of the Hijri calendar. His great-grandfather became Muslim at the hand of Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan رضي الله عنه. There are two Yazids that many Muslims might know one and not know the other. There is Yazid, the Sahaba of Prophet Muhammad, one of the Sahaba of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of the conquerors of Syria. He's called Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan. He is the elder brother of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, and he was one of the governors of Syria at the time of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, Amir al-Mu'minin. When Yazid passed away, his brother, younger brother Muawiyah, one of the greatest kings in Islamic history, if not the greatest of all kings, one of the most knowledgeable when it comes to rule, he became the leader of the governor of Syria, and later on he became the Khalifa of the Muslims, or one of the first kings in Islamic history. His son, Muawiyah, is also called Yazid. So the two Yazids, the brother of Muawiyah and the son of Muawiyah. This man, his great grandfather Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, he became a Muslim at the hand of the Sahabi Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan, one of the generals of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu. He became a Muslim at his hand, so he takes all his name. He's known as al-Yazidi. He comes from the people who accepted Islam at the hands of this man. Also, one of his grandfathers is amongst the very first people who entered Andalus with that man who was the most wanted man in the entire world. We mentioned previously, who was that man who was the most wanted in the entire world? Wanted dead or dead. He entered Andalus by himself, conquered Andalus, and ensured that Spain and Portugal remained in the hands of Muslim for another 700 years plus. Who is this man, Muhammad? Abdurrahman al-Dakhil. So the great grandfather of Ibn Hazm also entered Andalus together with this man. And this is a prominent family, Ikhwani Fillah. His father was a minister during the rule of a man called Al-Hajib al-Mansur. We did this in the previous series when we talk about Andalus. Al-Hajib al-Mansur is one of the greatest leaders of Islamic history. One of the few people in Islamic history who has never lost a single battle. He's never lost a single battle. The father of this imam was a minister, one of the closest ministers to this man, Al-Hajib al-Mansur, Muhammad ibn Abi Amir, rahimahullah. So he grew up in a house where his father was a minister. His father was very wealthy, that they had not a house or a palace, they had an entire village that was owned by them. Very wealthy family. His father was very eloquent, very articulate, and he used to feel ashamed when he is presented with someone who makes errors in the Arabic language. How do you make an error in the Arabic language? We are not Arabs. He, Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, he's Pharisee. He's from the Persians. He's not from the Arabs. And this is one of the amazing things about our Islamic history, Ikhwani fillah. Most of the scholars of Islam, they are not Arabs. I repeat, most of the scholars of Islamic history, they're not Arabs. Look at the greatest books of hadith. Imam Bukhari comes from Bukhara, that is in Uzbekistan. Imam Muslim in Isaburi, he comes from one of the stands. Imam Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Al-Qazwini, all these imams, Sijistani, maybe perhaps Abu Dawud is an Arab, the rest are Muslim, the rest are not Arabs. Most of the scholars of Islamic history are not Arabs, including this imam. He was Persian, but very eloquent, very knowledgeable in the Arabic language, one of the most eloquent people in Islamic history. So he grew up in this house, Ikhwani fillah. Initially, as was the way of many of the Muslims, till today in many countries, that you are taught by the women of the house. The women of the house are the ones that take care of the young children, teaching them the initial knowledge that is required for them. Teaching them the Quran, teaching them the Arabic language, poetry, fluency of the tongue, teaching them aqidah and many other subjects. So Ikhwani fillah, most of the scholars in Islamic history, you see Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, you see Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, you see many great scholars of Islamic history, you'll find from amongst the very first teachers or the very first professors or the very first people who taught them were women. What does this teach us? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, his wife Aisha radhiallahu anha, she has, according to some scholars, one third of Islamic knowledge is with Aisha radhiallahu anha. Because everything related to the house, the family, and every relation in the family, she is the one who is knowledgeable because she was present, viewing everything and learning from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So women education is very important, Ikhwani fillah. It does not go against our deen to teach our ladies, to teach our sisters, to teach our daughters, or even our mothers. Let them memorize the Quran. Let them learn in this old age. And mashallah, we have seen ladies, even in their 70s, 80s, they have memorized the entire Quran. So this imam, he studied under women of his house until he became very fluent in the Arabic language. Then this episode happened to him. Before that, Ikhwani fillah, in the year 400, as we mentioned, a lot of division happened in Andalus. There was a lot of civil war. Remember the mistake. We said the greatest leader that was produced by Andalus is a man called Abdurrahman al-Nasir. Abdurrahman al-Nasir was the Khalifa from the year 316 of the Hijri calendar to the year 350. The greatest leader ever produced by Spain, Muslim or Christian, is this man, Abdurrahman al-Nasir. Till today, the people of Spain remember him. His son, Hisham, took over. Then after Hisham got a stroke, he made a mistake. He took his young boy, Al-Hakam ibn Hisham, who was only 11 or 12 years of age, to be the leader of the Muslims in Andalus. So this led to the fall of the Umayyads in Andalus. Are you together? This fitna brought a lot of civil war and a lot of upheaval in the land of Andalus. His father, Ahmed bin Sa'id, the father of this scholar, in the year 402 of the Hijri calendar, his wealth was taken. He himself was imprisoned and he died in prison, rahimahullah. This imam was greatly affected by this. He was only 16 or 18 years of age. He was born in the year 384 of the Hijri calendar. So the year 402 is about 16 years of age. Some scholars say he was born in the year 386. So 16 to 18 years of age, it greatly affected him. But he continued with life until that event happened to him, khanifillah, when he was 26 years of age. He says, one person tells me, pray tahiyat al-masjid. Another person tells me, don't pray tahiyat al-masjid. So this gave him a lot of morale to go study the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ikhwanifillah, this is something that sometimes one small event that can look as minor to other people, it has a great effect on other people. Imam Bukhari, Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, he was in the sitting, or is in the gathering of Imam Ishaq ibn Rahawi, one of the scholars of hadith. Imam Ishaq ibn Rahawi, he says, I wish if someone was just to compile the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the authentic hadiths in one narration. It says, فَوَقَعَ ذَلِكَ فِي قَلْبِي فَأَخَذْتُ فِي جَمْعِ الْجَامِعِ الصَّحِيحِ. That really affected me. Those words, someone to just compile the hadiths that are authentic. He says, 16 years it took me and I compiled the hadith of Prophet alayhi sallam that are authentic. Imam al-Dhahabi, he was told, خَطُّكَ يُشْبِهُ خَطَّ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ. Your handwriting looks like the handwriting of the scholars of hadith. He says, that entered my heart and I started seeking the knowledge of hadith. This man, Imam Ibn Hazm, just that event of him being told, pray, the same day he told, don't pray tahat al-masjid, he sought out to seek knowledge, ikhwani fillah, until he became one of the greatest scholars of his time. Initially, ikhwani fillah, he started studying the madhab of Imam Malik. As we said in the previous lectures, that the madhab or the school of thought that the people of Andalus and the people of North Africa towards the West were following is the madhab of Imam Malik. The person who entered this madhab to the land of Spain is a man called Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi, rahimahullah. Kindly refer to the video we did previously about him. So the people of Andalus were following this madhab of Imam Yahya ibn Yahya al-Laythi, rahimahullah. So Ibn Hazm started studying the madhab of Imam Malik. Then he studies the madhab of Imam Shafi'i. He learns a lot. He loves Imam Shafi'i. Then he leaves this madhab. He follows a madhab of another third imam called Dawood al-Zahir. He says, I will only follow the Quran, the Sunnah, and the Ijma'. I will not follow anything called Qiyas. There's something in Islamic fiqh that is known as Qiyas. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told in the Quran that you should not take alcohol. But did he tell you not to take bang or cocaine or heroin or what other drugs are there? Whatever other drugs. Did he tell you not to, did he mention all these other drugs? Huh? Did Allah mention all the drugs? No. But you can tell, why is alcohol illegal? Because it intoxicates. Hence, anything else that has the same illah, intoxication, becomes haram as a result. So, marijuana has not been mentioned in the Quran. Cocaine, heroin, all these other drugs, I don't know, ecstasy or whatever they're called, not mentioned in the Quran. But based on this analogy or qiyas, we take it to be haram because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram alcohol based on intoxication, all these other things also on intoxication. So Imam Ibn Hazm refused this thing called qiyas. And from the funny things, from his madhab, the mistakes that he made, because he was following zahir, he was following what the Quran says and the Sunnah. I'm not going to enter in depth. I'm just following word for word what the Quran and the Sunnah says. For example, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam naha anil bawli fil ma'i raqid, al ma' alladhi la yajri. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam prohibited any Muslim from urinating in water that is stagnant, that is not moving. Are you understanding? This imam, he says, the Prophet refused us to urinate in water that is stagnant, not moving, but he did not refuse us to defecate in it. So we can defecate in that water. Is that okay? It doesn't make sense. He says, in a different, he says, the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, he says about the virgin, The lady who has not been married before, he says, idhnuha samtuha. That her permission is her being quiet. The virgin is shy. So if she's asked, do you want to be married to this person? If she keeps quiet and she starts laughing, you understand from that quietness that she is not against that idea of marriage and the marriage can proceed. For if she's against, she has to say no. But if she keeps quiet because of her shyness, it's understood, then you can proceed in marriage. That is the opinion of almost all the scholars. He says a different thing. He says, idhnuha sukutuha, idhnuha samtuha. Her permission is to keep quiet. But if she has the courage of saying yes, then the marriage is null and void. Says, how dare she say yes to the marriage? So this was something ridiculous from amongst the things that came from his madhab. However, ikhwani fillah, he's one of the greatest scholars of fiqh. Imam, one of the scholars is called Sultan al-Ulama. The Sultan, you know the Sultan, the king or the Sultan of the scholars, the leader of the scholars of his time. It's called Al-Izz ibn Abi Salam. This is the man who led the Muslims against the Mongolians in Ain Jalut, one of the scholars who participated in the battle of Ain Jalut. He says, مَا رَأَيْتُ فِي كُتُبِ الْإِسْلَامِ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مِثْلِ كِتَابِ الْمُغْنِي لِابْنِ قُدَامَ الْمَقْدِسِ وَكِتَابِ الْمُحَلَّى لِابْنِ حَزْمَ الْأَنْدَلُسِ. In fact, he said, Al-Muhalla before Al-Mughni. He said, I've not seen from the books of Islam that have more knowledge than the book Al-Muhalla written by this Imam we're talking about tonight from Andalus, Ibn Hazm, and the book Al-Mughni written by Al-Muwaffaq, Ibn Qudam Al-Maqdisi. These two books, I've not seen the likes of it. Imam Al-Dhahabi, rahimahullah, says, Sadaq Al-Imam. The Imam has spoken the truth. But I add two more books. He says, the third book is As-Sunan Al-Kubra by Imam Al-Bayhaqi. And the fourth book, At-Tamheed by Ibn Abdul Barr. Khani fillah, whoever manages to study these four books and learn it is truly a great scholar of Islam. Al-Muhalla by Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi that we've mentioned. Number two, Al-Mughni by Ibn Qudam al-Maqdisi. Number three, Sunan al-Kubra by Al-Bayhaqi. And number four, At-Tamheed, also by one of the scholars of Andalus, Ibn Abdul Barr. These are the four great books of fiqh in Islamic history. He also wrote other books, Tawq al-Hamama, Al-Fasl fil-Milal. He wrote great books, Khani fillah. And he's amongst the very first human beings to say that the world is round, not flat. Some people still believe in the flat theory that the world is flat. You can reach at the end and you fall over. But this Imam, 1,000 years ago, it's exactly 1,000 years ago, he taught and he claimed that the world is spherical, is round. It's not flat. Amongst them also Ibn Taymiyyah came on. Not Galileo or these other scholars that the Western historians taught us. Islamic or the Muslim scholars are the ones who studied this. Ikhwani fillah, the amazing thing about our Muslim scholars, they're not only scholars of Quran and Hadith and Fiqh and Islamic sciences. They're also scholars in mathematics, in physics, in astronomy and such. And he was also a scholar of astronomy. However, Ikhwani fillah, he came from a royal family. He came from a very rich family, Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi. Number one, he had a very severe tongue. The scholars, they say, Lisanu ibn Hazm wa Sayf al-Hajjaj shaqiqan. The tongue of Ibn Hazm and the sword of Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, who murdered many of the Sahabas and the Tabi'een, are twin brothers. The tongue of Ibn Hazm and the sword of Hajjaj are twin brothers. His tongue was very severe. So many of the scholars kept away from him. None wants to be engaged or to be participating with him. He engaged in a number of debates. One of the famous debates he had in Islamic history also is a debate that he had with the Imam Abu Walid al-Baji rahimahullah. Very interesting debate. But many of the scholars did not like him. Many of the students of knowledge did not like him. Many of the leaders did not like him. The leaders did not like him for one reason, because he came from the party supporting the Bani Umayyah, the family of the Umayyads, Abdurrahman al-Nasir, Hakam ibn Hisham, Hakam ibn Abdurrahman al-Nasir, Hisham ibn Hakam ibn Abdurrahman al-Nasir. They did not like this family. So, Khani fillah, he became a minister on three separate occasions. And every time he was removed after his leader was killed and he was jailed. Many times he was thrown in jail. Many times he was expelled. One day he goes to the city of Sevilla, Ishbilia, and he stays there. The leader of Ishbilia did not like him at all. Al-Mu'tadid ibn Abbad. So Al-Mu'tadid ibn Abbad starts making a claim that he comes from the royal family of the Bani Umayyah, that he is from the family of Hisham ibn al-Hakam ibn Abdurrahman al-Nasr ibn Hajar ibn Hazm. He says this is one of the greatest fabrications in history. So the leader hates him for this statement. And he commands the scholars that this person has come to change your religion. He has come to follow a path that the scholars do not know. And he says, burn all the books of Imam Ibn Hazm. So they look for the books of this scholar that they can find, and they burn many of his books. Ikhwani fillah, in Islamic history, a history spanning 1,400 years plus, the person who has written the most number of pages is an imam called Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah. The one who's written Tafsir al-Tabari. This is the greatest book of Tafsir that is present with us. The greatest Tafsir that is not present with us, we mentioned in the previous lecture, is the Tafsir of Baqi ibn Makhlad. Whoever finds that Tafsir, we as the Muslims will pay you, or the scholars and the students of knowledge will pay you billions of dollars. This is one of book, the Tafsir of Baqi ibn Makhlad, that the scholars are looking for a lot. But the greatest Tafsir that is present is the Tafsir of this Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. This is the scholar who's written the most number of pages in Islamic history. They calculated the number of pages he used to write. On average, he was writing 14 pages every day. How many pages? 14 pages every single day. One day he says, just for benefit, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he says to his students, هل تنشطون لتفسير كتاب الله? Are you guys active so I can write for you a book of the tafsir of the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla? They say, yes. كم يكون? كم قدره? How big is the book going to be? He says, 30,000 ألف ورقة. 30,000 papers. He says, this will take our entire life just to read this book. He says, ذهب الهمم. ذهبت الهمم. The ambition people have has gone. فاختصرها في 3,000 ورقة. He summarized it in 3,000 pages. Then he says to his students another time, هل تنشطون لتاريخ العالم من لدن آدم إلى يومنا هذا? Do you want me to write for you a book of history from the time of Adam عليه السلام, the first human being, to our time? They say, كم يكون قدره? How big is that book going to be? He says, 30,000 ورقة. 30,000 papers. 30,000 papers is about 60,000 pages, or even more in our time, because they used to write a lot in one page. Says, هَذَا مَا يُفْنَى الْأَعْمَارِ قَبْلَ إِتْمَامِهِ. This will end our lives even before we finish reading it, or perhaps even you before finishing writing it. Says, ذَهَبَتَ الْهِمَمْ فَاخْتَصَرَ فِي 3,000 وَرَقَةً. He summarized it in 3,000 pages. This is the greatest when it comes to writing. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Number two, يقول في الله, according to many scholars, is this imam we're talking about tonight, Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi. He wrote over 80,000 papers in his lifetime. One of the greatest writers or publishers or authors of Islamic books. You have number three, Imam Ibn Jawzi, and number four, number three, Imam As-Suyuti, rahimahumullah. These are the greatest authors of Islamic history. So Imam Ibn Hazm, his books were burned before his eyes. Great books he wrote, books that took months or weeks or years to write, something very painful to his heart. He went back to his village and continued researching and studying and spreading his knowledge. And he passed away, rahimahullah, in the year 456 of the Hijri calendar. From amongst his contemporaries, or one of the greatest scholars that lived in his time, is the Imam Ibn Abdul Barr, the one who authored a tamheed that we shall talk about in the forthcoming lecture, Imam Ibn Abdul Barr. Ikhwani fillah, for benefit, we mentioned maybe a long time ago, if you can remember, when we're talking about Zakat al-Fitr. We say Zakat al-Fitri becomes obligatory on the last day of Ramadan at the time of Maghrib. Are you together? Zakat al-Fitri is an obligation upon us who have fasted the month of Ramadan to give out in food. So the obligation happens on the last day of Ramadan at the time of Maghrib. Then we said someone like Imam Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, he passed away on the last day of Ramadan before Maghrib. Are you together? The Muslims prayed Salat al-Eid and they prayed the Salat al-Janaza on Imam Bukhari. Is Zakat al-Fitri obligatory, or was Zakat al-Fitri obligatory on Imam Bukhari? No, because he died before the time of obligation, which is the time of Maghrib. This Imam Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, the opposite. He was born in the year 384 or 386 on the 30th of Ramadan before Maghrib. So it became wajib on him, this young baby born at that time. Zakat al-Fitr became obligatory upon him to be paid by his father or his guardian. This is just for benefit. So Khanifillah, this is one of the greatest scholars, perhaps the greatest scholar to come from the land of Andalus. He learned a lot of Islamic sciences and a lot of Islamic knowledge. The Imam Abu Muhammad Ali ibn Ahmed ibn Sa'id ibn Hazm al-Andalusi rahimahullah, who passed away in the year 456 of the Hijri calendar. Inshallah, we shall continue with our lecture in the forthcoming week on Friday, Saturday and Sunday. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.